Good evening and welcome to the Fitzroy Club, the comedy nights that return second of this kind in the Fitzroy Club. I'm very happy that you are here and I'm very happy that I am here. I just came from a 4 weeks tour around Denmark, visiting the smallest villages you can imagine out in the outskirts of Denmark. You know, where we see cows in the streets almost, it's dark at night. Everybody knows everything about anybody. You can't have any secrets. And at the local pub, the same five guys meet every night telling the same jokes and telling the same stories. So I'm very pleased to be back here in Primrose Hill, where it's kind of the same. But still, we have the Fitzroy Club. And what is the Fitzroy Club? A lot of people ask me, and there seems to be quite a few rumors about what it is. I heard one said, claimed it was a swinger club in an iceberg basement down in number 53, but that's not true. I also heard people said, oh, it's just another name for the community center, which is also not true. And Virginia thought, oh, it's a private club for people living in Primrose Road. And that's almost correct, because it is a private club, but you're all members. As long as you live in Primrose Hill, or you work in Primrose Hill, or you just would love to live in Primrose Hill if you could afford it. So it's also what we call a... what we call now a social enterprise. And those two words, I can tell it all. It's about making money and having fun at the same time, and that's what we try to do. And I think we could make money if we didn't have that ridiculous low prices at the bar, £2.50 for a beer and £3 for a glass of wine. So if the prices were higher and we would make money, that part of it would go to the community center, and the rest of it would go to making even better events in the future. And we have already a few other events coming up. On the 19th of October, we have Primrose Hill Entrepreneurs and Innovators evening. And that's for local residents with all having remarkable stories about how they built the business. It's Andrew, who did the Aduna and won a lot of prizes. It's Flip with her mushroom pate. We have a bank owner that just opens his own new bank, and we have a guy who started as a milk deliverer and now he's owning and running one of the most profitable and biggest property developing companies in the world, in UK, sorry, yeah. So it's going to be very, and they'll tell the story about the success, but also about all the failures, which you usually won't hear, but you learn often more from your failures than you learn from your success. So anyway, back to, that's the 19th of October, you're very welcome. It's free at admission as tonight. So back to tonight. I'm sure everybody who were at the first comedy night thought, as I thought, this can't be done better. No way. But I believe that Trish did it again. She has compiled a really impressive lineup. I think you'll agree. So I hope you'll enjoy yourself. I have to thank a few people. First of all, our sponsors, and that's Morford from Greenberry Cafe, who gave the wine. Ross and Albert from Fifth Dimension Chocolate, who have the prize. It's Pete from Olive's Bar in at the Market, and it's Sebastian from Olivier's Bakery also in the market. And please, they support us, so please support our sponsors, so everybody's happy. Now, I think the only thing I'll say now is thank you to the team as usual. It's Trish, it's Phil, it's Jason, it's Peter, it's Susie and Sue and Bryn and Mick. I think I got them all together, all of them. And then, Young, let's say now I'll leave the mic for the rest of the, I won't disturb you anymore, leave the mic to our special and lovely MC for tonight, which again is Pauline.
Special. Haven't been called that since school. Special and lovely. Thank you very much, Lars. Good evening. Welcome to Fitzroy Comedy Club. Give me a cheer if you were here last time. We did this back in June. Give me a cheer. Some of you were. Give me a cheer if you weren't. Oh, you sound a little happier. A bit worrying. Last time I was here, it was lovely. It was lovely to be, you know, lovely to be back in Primrose. It was the day of Brexit when we did this before, and we just found out. So we were all a bit all over the place, weren't we? We were slightly worried about what was going to happen. But it's fine, because everything's turned out. Yeah, it's all been a bit. And then we lost that wonderful leader as well, didn't we? Which was a bit gutting the week after. I don't know. I always loved him. I did, because he was, his judgments were always good, really correct. And he was always so twinkly-eyed and fantastic and always beautifully turned out. Not like those other clowns that he used to, you know, share a bench with. Strictly, it's just not going to be the same without Len, is it? it's been a huge summer. Had a good summer?
Yeah.
We've had good weather. Yeah, I've got a tan. Fantastic. So nice. This is an Essex tan. Sodgy south of France. Sodgy Primrose Hill, who can afford the south of France. Essentially tan here. It's been lovely. So you're very welcome. We have 8 fantastic acts, possibly 9 if somebody local stands up. Anybody local fancy having a go tonight? If any of you fancy having a go, come see Trish and me and we'll say no. Do I come to your place of work? So what do you do? Oh, I'm a doctor. Oh, can I do 5 minutes in surgery? I'll be fine. I've got Google. We'll be fine. No, but seriously, if you fancy coming having a go, have a chat with Trish. Or maybe it makes you think, you know what? Next time they do this, I'd like to have a go. Then come and talk to us and do, because it's incredibly hard and skilled, but we make it look easy and that will inspire you. So that's good. Since we met last time, those of us who did, I've been celebrating a big birthday. They say thank you. They say you should never ask a lady her age. Bollocks to that. I'm 50, and I'm not a lady. Thank you. Not a lady. Never wanted to be a lady, which is just as well. My mum was a lady when she was my age, and she had like a shampoo and set and high heels and a green dress with acorns on it. That's the 70s for you. But they say, don't they? They say age is just a number. You're as old as you feel. I feel 50. You know? That's fine. When I was 30, I looked in the mirror and thought, oh, a tan. Now I look in the mirror and think, oh, some damage in the shape of cheekbones. Saving me a fortune on blusher. We're all winning. Now, when I was 20, I looked in the mirror and I think, I hate my face. I hate my body. And now I look in the mirror and think, still hanging on. Yeah! And I'm too old to say hashtag winning, but if I wasn't, hashtag winning. And at least I'm not like one of those men. You know what men are like when they get to 50? Bloody midlife crisis, you know. They go and buy a leather jacket and a motorbike and go off to Glastonbury and flirt with 20-year-old women. It's a pathetic attempt at getting some attention, really, isn't it? I'd never be like that. So I started doing stand-up. And I love my stand-up. I booked to appear at a comedy gig recently, and the guy, just like Trish did for tonight, he made a Facebook page for the event. There's a whole list of comedians on there. When I looked at it, my name wasn't on there. He'd messed me up. I knew what it was. I knew straight away, because I've read the articles. I'm sure we all have, haven't we? Women over 50 are invisible. And just because I'm no longer in the running to be Britain's next top model, you can't see me. Don't worry, you don't have to laugh. That's fine. It's fine if you didn't laugh. I mean, I don't really aspire to being a model. I couldn't commit, you know, to putting on that much height. But I called the guy out on it. I said, you sexist, ageist bastard, you've left me off that list. I did. And he said, I think you're looking at last month's event, not this month's event. Oh, the irony. I'm not having periods and I don't know what month it is. Yeah, I was at my therapy group and And this guy stood up, and we were all sitting, you know, like you do. And he stood up and he said, my name's Matt and I'm a serial killer. And the next guy stood up, he said, I'm Roberto and I'm cruel to animals. My name's Pauline, I need to get out of this vicious circle. I know, right, that's the level for tonight. I've set the bar nice and low, so the fabulous people coming on next, you know, you're going to love them. Anybody never been to live comedy before? You've all seen live comedy before. Who have you seen? Give me a shout, somebody. Who have you seen live? Anyone big? Jimmy Carr. Was he good? Yeah. Yeah? Was he doing the abuse to the audience stuff? Yeah. When people heckled? Yeah.
It's in Iceland.
Ah, in Iceland. And so he was, and then people were heckling in Icelandic or in English?
Yeah.
He'd abuse them anyway. Yeah. It's going to be just like that tonight. If you're rude to any of us, we will cut you down. Or cry and leave the stage. Something like that. Jimmy Carr, that's cool. Anybody else seen anybody big? Was he good?
Ooh,
was he? Now, he's brilliant off the cuff as well. He had horrible shoes on. I've got shoes with moustaches on because I don't dress my age. Because what does that mean? Brilliant. Anyone else seen anyone else famous? Really good. Who's Jo Brand? What was she like? Was she? I saw her last year. She was preparing for Edinburgh. She hadn't prepared anything. And she was very, when she sort of ad-libbed and stuff, she was amazing. But the stuff that she hadn't prepared wasn't quite ready yet. But when you're Jo Brand, you can still be brilliant. So, sod you. It's very important, actually, what I've learned from doing comedy is when you go to see somebody, if they're not that great, it's you that's wrong, for one thing. And also, you can see people on a bad night. So you can see amazing comedians, and they might not be very good. Whereas tonight, they're a bit crap, but they're going to be really funny. So that's good. The other thing to remember is the more you drink, the funnier we are. And that keeps both sponsors and Lars very happy indeed. Fantastic. So hopefully tonight, you're going to see some people that you think in a couple of years' time. Saw them. Saw them at the Fitzroy Club. And they were amazing. Yeah, we see that Sean Sellers. Wow, now he's on live at the Apollo, but when we saw him, he was even better. Are you ready to meet Sean?
Yeah.
He's fantastic. He's your opening act tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, all the way from the back of the room, it's Sean Sellers!
Thank you. Thank you very much. Nice to see you. Hello. Hello, Fitzroy Club. Hi. What's that? I look fantastic? Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. I do look fantastic. You agree, right? Yeah, because I do. I look fantastic. I look fantastic. Thank you. Thank you. I mean, stop. But it's embarrassing, but it's true. So, you know, thanks. I look at the way I'm dressed, right? Can you get a load of this? Do I need to move this out of the way?
Take it in. Soak it in.
Yeah, because... I think, you know, I'm big into fashion, right? I think the way that you dress says a lot about you, about the kind of version of you you want to present to the world, how you want people to see you, how you want to be perceived. And so I get asked every once in a while how I would describe this, right? Like how I would describe my style. And I describe my style in three simple words. And those words are gay, French accountant. Right, because you can see it a little bit, right? Like, it's a little bit business, it's a little bit formal, checkered jacket, right? But it's also, it's a little bit chic, it's a little bit suave, scarf. Like, I feel like I could pull off a pencil mustache, do you know what I mean? Like, can we get a vote on this? Because I did this the other week. I split the room, right, when I asked, what do you think? Can I pull off a pencil mustache?
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you. I think I can, yeah. But more important than anything else, I look utterly fabulous. Right?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Like if I had to describe your style, guy, what's your name, by the way?
Peter.
Peter, hi. Peter, Sean.
And that's
Peter, if I had to describe your style, I would probably go with, like, jazz busker.
Exactly.
Right? Because, like, can you see, like, the hat? Like, I can imagine you, like, on a bridge with the hat down, kind of scatting. Right? Like, you know what I mean. You look like a fairly young guy, right? When I was young, like when I was about 5 years old, I'm not saying you're 5 years old, right? Like, you've got a beard, I get it. But like when I was about 5 years old, I used to wear cowboy boots, short shorts, a Star Trek t-shirt with a picture of Captain Kirk fighting the Gorn, you know, that giant alien lizard thing. A cowboy hat, because I'm from Oklahoma, a cowboy hat, and an apron folded in half and worn around my waist like a skirt. Right? Because I guess what I'm saying is, like, I've always been fashion forward, right? Right? Like, I always, like, I don't have a job, right? Like, this is just the way, this is literally just the way I dress. I did not do this for tonight. I did not dress up for you. Sorry. This is just the way I dress. Like, today, I sat on the couch with a bottle of champagne and watched back-to-back episodes of Frasier on Netflix. Right? Because sophistication. Right? They deserve champagne when you watch that. Like, you can't watch that with a beer. These are smart guys. That's what I'm saying. So, you know, I guess I feel the same way about tattoos as I do about fashion, right? Like, you guys look like, maybe somebody over here has a tattoo. You're young people. Like, when I got my first tattoo, I thought really long and hard about it, right? Like, I wanted it to be unique. I wanted it to be original. I wanted it to speak to me as a person. Like, if I'm going to dress like this, I should have a tattoo that's something better than, like, you know, a bird on my shoulder. So I thought about it before I did it, and I think if any of you are out there and you're thinking about getting a tattoo, the thing is, a bad tattoo is tough to escape, right? Like, even the mic knows that a bad tattoo is tough to escape. It wanted that to be clear. Like, that was a salient point for all of you. Like, a bad tattoo is tough to escape. So you gotta choose wisely, right? Like, that's why, word of advice, you should never, ever get the name of any other human being tattooed anywhere on your body, right? Unless you are absolutely convinced they're your kid. That's the one pass, right? Like, even David Beckham wasn't stupid enough to get Victoria's name tattooed anywhere on his body. No, right? Instead, he got the names of his kids, right? So Romeo, Brooklyn, Harper 7, and Cruz David. These are their actual names, right? Like, that's and I'm all for, like, a creative baby name. Like, I get that. That's okay. Because, like, I'm having a baby in February, and I'm very excited about it. I want to call the baby Boba Fett. That's not a joke, even though my wife has already told me, like, that will never, ever happen, right? In my heart, I want to call it Boba Fett, because I think that ahead of the curve, right? There are no Boba Fetts. She'd be the only one. And I think it'd be a great name for a girl, right? Like, Boba Fett Sellers. Of course it would. It would be awesome. So I get the crazy name thing, right? Like, I get it. Because the thing about names, right, is the same thing about tattoos. They last forever. They're permanent. And when you pretend that they're not, and you try to change them afterwards, they never, ever quite look right. Case in point, Cheryl Cole from Girls Aloud. Right? Do we know this woman? We know Cheryl Cole. We know her from the X Factor, if nothing else. Right? We know her maybe from the hair ads. Like, Cheryl had a tattoo, and she got it changed. Because how else could you explain? Like, sir, how else could you explain a giant tattoo across your back of a bouquet of roses coming out of your ass? Yeah. Right? Now, to be fair to Cheryl, okay, to be fair to Cheryl, that is the tattoo she has, right? Like, that is what she has. To be fair to Cheryl, that started off as a single rose. Yeah. Yeah, it did. Yeah. But as we all know, shit makes great fertilizer, right? Like, that's just science, Cheryl. That's just science. Right? Like, grow all you want, but it's science. Like, that's a science fact. Right? Because pretty soon, you're going to need a weed whacker to trim that bush. Right? That's all I'm saying. Like that, and I don't know, like, Cheryl, what were you thinking? Right? Like, what were you thinking? Because eventually it's going to get so thorny back there that it's going to be almost impossible to avoid the occasional prick up the bum. And you already put Ashley Cole behind you once.
No.
That was my football joke. You're welcome. So turning directions a little bit, I realize I haven't really introduced myself, so I'll introduce myself very quickly. So my name is Sean. My name is Sean Sellers. I'm from America. Right, surprise. I'm not that polite. I'm not Canadian. I'm American. In fact, I'm actually a Mexican American. I know it's hard to believe with a name like Sean Sellers, but it's true. It is true. It's just that this is what Mexican looks like when it hasn't seen the sun in ages. Right, because living here, I've been here a while, like living here, I feel like all the color is slowly drained from my body. Right, like I'm like a vampire now, except instead of wanting to suck your blood, I want to take your melanin. Unfortunately, you're a mostly pasty people, right? So that isn't working out. But that's kind of a joke. Like, I don't bite Lubo yet. But, you know, like, in part, I'm just hanging out until after the American election in November to find out whether or not I'm lucky enough to get to build the wall. Yeah. Right, because, like, either way, I'm going to get my color back, right? Because, like, this looks good in the tan. That's all I'm saying. Like, when Pauline, when it happens, like, when I built the wall, yeah, we're going to compare notes, and I will look fantastic. I will look fantastic. So just before I go, I'll tell you a little bit about my future president, Donald Trump. Suck it up, it's gonna happen. don't moan at me, I'm not voting for him. Although, I kind of like, maybe I should just hold that against you. If you don't laugh tonight, I'm voting for Donald Trump. Yeah, let's see how you like that. You turn against me, I'll turn against you. So here's something about Donald Trump you might not know. Donald Trump was nominated for a Nobel Peace Prize. That is the right response, but that is also a true story.
No.
Yes, Donald Trump was nominated for a Nobel Peace Prize by an anonymous American politician that I like to call Sarah Palin. Right, because I'm not going to wait the 50 years it takes to find out who it really was when I've already decided it was Sarah Palin. She endorsed him for president. She's nominated him for a Nobel Peace Prize. Of course she did. It just makes sense. Why? Because crazy attracts crazy. That's how it works. Right, that's how it works. Like, case in point, the actor Sean Penn found America's public enemy number one. Right, the guy who replaced Osama bin Laden on the most wanted list, El Chapo Guzman, with the help of a Mexican soap star. Right, with the help of a Mexican soap star, Sean Penn found El Chapo. I'm gonna say that again. With the help of a Mexican soap star, El Chapo invited Sean Penn to his secret lair in Mexico to be interviewed for Rolling Stone magazine. Okay, now to put that into context for you, right? That would be like if al-Baghdadi, head of ISIS, contacted Barbara Windsor to have Ross Kemp come down to Iraq to do one of those documentaries that he makes for Sky One. And what did El Chapo want to talk about? El Chapo wants to make a movie about El Chapo. Of course he does. Of course he does. He's in Netflix. He's got Narcos. He has a score. But like, I've been doing that joke for almost 6 months now, right? And it has finally come true. They are making a show about El Chapo. No. Yes, I'm like a prophet. On that, and me having told you Donald Trump will be president, I've warned you now. Let's find out. Thank you very much. I've been Sean Sellers. I've threatened you with a president that you won't want. Good night. have a great night. Thanks very much.
I made a discovery about the lights. If they're too really fast, they go flashy, flashy, flashy. And when I stop, they stay the same colour. And we're going to have so much fun with this tonight. Brilliant. Fun. Going to have fun. Going to have fun because as well as being 50, I'm going through the menopause and that's not fucking funny. Okay, I am irritable, I am hormonal, I am forgetful at times, so you'll have to forgive me if I forget stuff, and I'm coming to terms with the fact that I will never present Country File. So it's a tough time for me at the moment. I get, you know, wound up. So if anything goes wrong tonight, it's a warning. But it's not going to go wrong for the next 10 minutes or so, because you've got someone fabulous next. I can say that really fast, and then the light flash. Or I can say it slowly. I love this. I'm one of these at home when I'm telling my kids off. Don't do that! And it flashes behind me. Sorry, because it scared them. Are you ready for another act?
Yeah.
She's going to be
off.
So when you put the
act,
when you put that in there,
yeah,
you have to hold it up.
One, two. Oh. One, two, one, two. What are you looking for? It's okay, we're fine, we're safe. Are you ready for another act?
Yeah!
Shall I bring on somebody fabulous? Yeah! She is fabulous, her name is Amira Saeed. Please give her a huge, lovely welcome! Thank you, Pauline. Thank you. Hello, everyone, good evening.
Hello.
Hi. I was in Boots the other day, at the store, not the footwear, although I have friends who own Boots and they're perfectly normal, decent people. But I was in Boots the other day collecting a prescription for my mother, and I handed the prescription to the pharmacist, and a few minutes later she said, "Ina Sabe," which by good fortune happens to be my mother's name. So I collected the prescription and the pharmacist said, "My God, you look good for your age." And now my mother, she's a beautiful woman, but and she's very youthful, but she is, as a matter of biological fact, 72 years old. So I said to the pharmacist, "This prescription is for my mother." And she said, "Oh, because I was going to ask you how you managed to look so good for a 72-year-old. And I said, "The way I look good for a 72-year-old is by being a 44-year-old. And I stormed out. I told my mother about this, and she was very sympathetic. And she said, "Well, at least you're not one of those women who is losing their looks as they get older." And I said, "Well, thank you, Mum." And she said, "That's okay. You never really had any looks to start with." And I said, thanks, Mum. And she said, "No, when you've brushed your hair and you're wearing something nice from Marks and Spencer, you can look perfectly presentable. But what about those women who are very beautiful when they're young, but then they lose their looks as they get older?" And I thought, yes, it must be awful to be very beautiful, have great sex with other beautiful people for 30 years, as opposed to being below average looking, having below average sex with below average looking people, but for 60 years. My mum felt quite bad that she had effectively called me a dog. And so she said that she would buy me lunch the next day after I'd been to the hairdresser. Believe it or not, I do actually get this done professionally. And so I was waiting in the hairdresser the next day for my stylist. And the girl in reception, who I can only assume was there by virtue of some kind of bring your child to work day, said to me, "Would you like to read a magazine?" And I said, "No, thank you." And she said, "Wouldn't you like to check your horoscope?" And I said, "No, I don't really believe in horoscopes, but I think that's because I'm Cancerian and we are naturally skeptical." My hairdresser, William, came to collect me and he sat me down and he said, "Coarse and dry." And I thought, gosh, I haven't even said anything yet. But he apparently was talking about my hair. He began cutting my hair and in the middle he said, "You do realise that you're virtually white." I said, "I think the technical term is anemia." And he said, "No, your hair is virtually white. Have you thought about having a colour correction?" And I said, "Well, how much would that cost?" And he said, "About £200. And I said, "How much would it cost just to have a colour?" And he said, "That would be £100. I said, "Okay, I'll think about it." About an hour later, 10 minutes of which consisted of William using a pair of scissors in a fairly amateur fashion, and 50 minutes of which consisted of William telling me about his disastrous love life. He said, "There you go, I've finished. Now, can I give you a piece of advice?" And I thought, well, if the advice is that I could have got my 12-year-old goddaughter to cut my hair, she would have done a better job, and all I would have had to listen to is her telling me about her eating disorder, then no, I don't really need the advice. But he said, "You don't need to pay full rate when you come in here. You should take advantage of the discounts that we offer earlier in the week." And I said, what discounts? And he said, "Has no one told you about Menopause Monday?" And I said, "What makes you think I'm going to the menopause?" And he said, "I've never known anyone sweat as much when I've been drying their hair." And I said, "The reason I'm sweating was because you were holding the microphone? Hair dryer so close to my scalp. I couldn't work out giving me a blow dry or reenacting a welding scene from Flashdance." Anyway, I stormed off. As I was storming off, I flung open the door of the salon and I yelled, "I still have periods. In fact, I'm having a period right now." And I opened the door and my mother was standing outside the salon talking to an elderly gentleman. My mother was quite mortified, but the gentleman was quite sweet. He just smiled. But he is one of the more progressive imams at the mosque. So yes, I think I am struggling with getting older. This includes when I go to see a doctor, when I go to the GP. I cannot accept medical advice from anyone under the age of 30. I know what my professional advice was like when I was 30, and it was rubbish. In fact, I wouldn't even call it advice. I would call it words coming out of a frightened mouth. So that's a problem I have. Apart from with Dr. Morris. Dr. Morris, he's very nice, actually. We were having a lovely conversation the other day, and he said to me, "Do you mind if I say something?" And I thought, hello, am I going to be propositioned in a room containing swabs? And how do I feel about that? And then I thought, I feel fine. I'm not the one regulated by the General Medical Council. And he said to me, "When I talk to you, I feel very much like I'm talking to my mother. And I said, oh, that's lovely. And he said, yes, she died last year. I really miss her. So I thought, not only do I remind him of his mother, I remind him of his dead mother. And so I said to him, well, anyway, back to the reason why I'm here. What do you think is wrong with me? And he said, well, the symptoms you're describing sound like menopause, at which point, obviously, I stormed out. Not before yelling something which my hairdresser, William, would have certainly described as coarse, but not necessarily very dry. Anyway, on Monday, I'm giving evidence at a General Medical Council tribunal. Dr. Morris claims that all he said was that I reminded him of his mother, but my recollection is that he asked me to do certain things to him using a spatula. It's funny, isn't it, how menopause can play tricks with one's memory? Anyway, all I want from the tribunal is for justice to be done and to receive enough compensation that I can afford to have a colour correction. Failing that just a colour, that would be fine. Anyway, I'll let you know how I get on at the tribunal, but thank you very much for listening, and good night.
She's wonderful. So that was Amira, and I'm Pauline. I have chestnut brown hair. I have chestnut brown ears. Chestnut brown back of my neck. And a whole chestnut brown bathroom. Yeah, because I can't afford a colour correction either. And I do it at home. So another woman next. Well, normally when you go to comedy clubs, you don't get women. Because they're not funny. Thanks for laughing. Me? Might get sensitive, menopausal. But we got two in a row here, so that's a bit weird. And me in between, so I quite understand if you walk out, because it's not supposed to be, you know, you'd never get that one mocked the week, would you? Three. It's a bit weird. Anyway, this one's fantastic as well, and she's right behind me. So I'd better say nice things about her, because I was about to slag her off horrendously because I thought she was in the toilet. But if she's right here, maybe I'll be nice. I imagine you'd like the microphone in the stand, would you, Janice? Okay, because otherwise that looks a bit uncomfortable. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage, Janice Hayes!
Oh, thank you. How lovely to be here. And I'm liking this room. I'm feeling lots of love. When you do lots of comedy nights, there's lots and lots of 20-year-olds in the room. And the grown-ups have the room tonight. Yeah. Got a couple of nice, fresh-faced young ones down here. I expect you finished your homework. Anyway, so we've got the room, ladies and gentlemen, and it's rather lovely. And there's obviously lots of material about our room. Our middle-aged condition, because it all goes a bit tits up, doesn't it? Tits down. Thank you. Yeah, someone had to say it, didn't they? Thank you very much. It gets a bit depressing. We all get a bit knackered. That's what we say, we're a bit knackered, aren't we? And I'm no different. I thought I'd take myself off for a bit of a treat down to the local spa. Now, I've never been to the local spa. I silently judge it from the outside. It's the sort of place where you go and ladies of a certain age frequent said spa. You know, they need their stress relief as much as anybody. All those endless lunches, hours of hot yoga, and darling, we know how many blowjobs it takes to keep that BMW on the driveway. I know, it's outrageous. But anyway, decided I needed a treat, so I went in. The first thing I noticed when I got into said spa was all of the women in this spa, they're really tall, okay? Unlike moi. So they've got these, they're amazing. Seriously, they're like a different species. It's quite incredible. They've got these long, amazing, shapely legs and long, elegant necks and surprisingly impressive eyelashes. And I felt like a meerkat who wandered into a herd of baby surprised giraffes. It's kind of weird. Actually, fun fact about giraffes. Do you know, right, that a giraffe can stick its tongue out 45 centimetres? That's like That's amazing. Have you any idea the BMW or a time like that can get you? It's true. See, this is, yeah. At my tongue. That's why I drive a Nissan Micra. It's tough, isn't it, eh? I don't know. What happened to the fairy tale? That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to stick this back in here. It's going to make... Oh, it's a tight fit, Vicar, isn't it? What happened to the fairy tale? That's what I want to know. Because we were sold the fairy tale, weren't we, ladies?
Yeah.
Do you remember when we were told we were going to be the princess? And it's all about the prince, wasn't it? All about the sparkly dress and the prince. Oh, kiddies, just to let you know, it's a vicious lie. I don't believe it. I'm more interested in the evil queen these days. Because I think the evil queen is much maligned. I think she's much more interesting than the Disney princess. But I think there's a sort of loop going on. And I want to know how the evil queen got to be the evil queen. Yeah? So, I've written this song. This is my version of how it might have happened. And it starts off in familiar fashion. So we begin with the princess. I worked my fingers to the bone, but I was never bitter. I sang along with bunnies, danced with every furry critter. And I sang one day my prince would come, and I saw nothing alarming, cause he and I would fall in love, and he would be quite charming. Imagine then my shock, to find my prince preferring cock. So fuck you, Mr. Disney, I just don't see the joke. Call me Mrs. Negative, you're one signature bloke. Cause I'm what happens after, the happy ever after. That nauseating fairy tale of every sweet 16, yeah. Fuck you, Mr. Disney. I'm the evil queen. I thought my dreams would all come true when he and I first met. My friends, the furry animals, and I sang a duet. But after fireworks filled the sky and the credits all did roll, the prince confessed he was repressed. To the huntsman, he must go. He said, it's nothing personal, dear, try not to be glum. The dress was a sensation, I just like it up the bum. Oh, fuck you, Mr. Disney, I just don't see the joke. Call me Mrs. Negative, you're one signature bloke. You know this fairy tale's baloney, you promised matrimony. Sometimes I get so bored I wanna scream, so I strangle the old kitten. I'm the evil queen. Sad bit now. The next few years were cold and sad. I spent them all alone. The prince ran off so he could be the queen all on his own. I had sex with every stable boy, I got quite a reputation. I had a different kind of ball, not fit for animation. But the mirror now on the wall says, sorry to be tough. Girl, you've partied way too hard, and man, you're looking rough. Fuck you, Mr. Disney, I just don't see the joke. Call me Mrs. Negative, you're one signature bloke. I used to be a stunner, but my prince was just a bummer. I'm sorry if you think I'm being mean. Come on, children, look at it from my side. I'm the evil queen. So here I sit in middle age, a grumpy bloody bird. My knees both creak, my bladder's weak, my eyesight's getting blurred. So if some irritating princess wants to sing and dance with the bunnies, a swift annihilation with a peck might be funny. Well, I know that I've been much maligned, some call me psychopathic, but I would say in my defense I'm just enthusiastic. So, forgive Mr. Disney, I just don't see the joke. Call me Mrs. Negative, you're one signature blood still. Once you reach the menopausal bit, you find you just don't give a shit. Is it so bad to poison the octane? Well, you might as well enjoy it. I'm the evil queen.
When they hit menopause, oh my god, never be like that. Nice job, Dennis Hayes, ladies and gentlemen. And we have one more act for you in this half, and then we're going to have a 20 minute break or so. And then when we come back, four or five acts in the second half as well. We haven't quite confirmed that yet, just in case any of you come up to us in the break and say, oh yes, please, me. So bear with us for another, well, don't bear with us, enjoy one more fabulous act before your break, and then a few more in the second half. You're having a good time.
Yes.
It's going well, yes?
Yeah.
It's all right. I've had a tough week, actually, because I was on my bike last Saturday, and as I was riding along the main road, the steering went, which was really scary, so I had to take it to a bike shop. And I picked it up just this afternoon. I picked my bike up from the bike shop, and as I was riding it home, the brakes failed. Can you believe it? I thought, I've got to get off this vicious cycle. I did. Ready for your final act in this half? Makes him a mini headliner in my book. Mini headliner, are you ready to welcome him to the stage? Oh.
Yes.
Nah, sorry, it's not good enough. I need you loud. I need you loud.
Yes.
Yes. Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready to meet Eyre McDonald?
Yes.
Please welcome him to the stage.
Oh, thank you very much indeed. Wow, it's good to be here. Primrose Hill. I have been told by people in the know that you get to play Primrose Hill twice. Once on the way up and once on the way down. So, ladies and gentlemen, it's great to be back. And it's fun to be part of what's going on tonight. And 2016, it's proving a bit of a year, isn't it? We've lost a lot of people this year. I mean, look back and call it the Chinese year of the dodo. And I was particularly saddened just before the summer. We lost Gordon Murray. Anyone know who Gordon Murray is? Oh, dear. Oh, let me educate you. He's the guy who gave us Trumpton. A bit of recognition. Younger people going, I have no idea what's going on. But Trumpton, very, very important. And you know, although I was sad, I had a wonderful mental image of the funeral, of the pallbearers being seven burly firemen. You know who I'm talking about, don't you? Yeah? Ding! Pew! Yeah, see, that had to be dredged from the very back of your mind there, didn't it? Let's try that again. Here we go. Pew! Pew! Barley McGrew, Cuthbert Dibble Grub. So we've established a bit of a middle-aged vibe this evening, and that confirms that. Let's just test that theory out a little bit more. Nuts, whole hazelnuts. Ha! Oh, I'm impressed. Oh, the crumbliest, flakiest chocolate.
Tastes like chocolate, never tasted
before. Oh, you blessed me there. Although, I was always worried by that slogan, you know, tastes like chocolate, never tasted before. I mean, that's a Hershey bar for me, and I never, ever, you know, want to taste one of those again. That would just be, that would be grim. Yeah, that whole era, the adverts were great, but there was some weird stuff for those of you who also grew up in the 70s and 80s. Does anyone remember that Bird's Eye used to advertise burgers, and they were very proud of the fact they were 60% beef? Do you remember that? They were really proud of that. 60% beef. You know, and as a kid, I thought the other 40% was burger or something. I had no idea what was going on. And also, when I was a kid, vanilla meant, I thought it was a posh word for no flavour. Because you had, like, chocolate ice cream, and you had strawberry ice cream, or you had the white no-flavour stuff that was called vanilla. But sometime in the 1990s, someone must have invented the flavour vanilla, and now things genuinely taste of something. So it's very, very confusing. And back in those days, oh, happy days, my friends, Mars bars weighed 65 grams. 65 grams. Oh, yeah. Now, 51 grams. 51 grams. That is daylight robbery. Because I was upset when Pluto was downgraded from being a planet. Were you? I mean, that was a blow. That's a part of my childhood. That was an important planet. I don't think if you've been given planet status, you should lose it. You know, that just doesn't seem fair. If we're going to start reassessing stuff as not being the real deal. I mean, if I was the Baltic Sea right now, I'd be nervous. I'm going to lose my status as a sea or ocean. But I think we should do the same thing with chocolate bars. You know, if we're taking a Mars bar from 65 grams down to 51 grams, I don't think it should qualify as chocolate bar anymore. It should be a chocolate sample. So I think that's important. And as you're well aware, dairy milks reduced by 8%. Anyone had one recently? They've gone curvy. You know, wasn't that a sly trick? It makes it look a little bit different, but they just robbed 8% of the chocolate. Not happy about that. This week, I popped into rather a posh pub. Right? It was a bit of a mistake. I thought I'd have a sandwich, but it turned out to be a little bit anything. But I did look at the menu, and I was most amused that they had seasonal soup of the moment. And, you know, as a comedian, that was great. So I said, could you tell me what the soup of the moment is? And it was leek and potato. I left it 15 seconds. And I said, could you tell me what the soup of the moment is? Still leek and potato. And when I asked again, just before they threw me out, it was still leek and potato. But it did confirm an ambition in me that I do want to go to waiter school. I want to go and learn how to be a waiter. Because I want to understand why waiters are trained to respond to the question, what is the soup of the day, with the same response every time. I'll just go and find out. I just think we could change the training a little bit, which would let me, when you arrive on your shift, have a word with the kitchen. Rather than this liturgical, what's the soup of the day? I'll just go and find out. But I did have a glorious experience of this in Birmingham. This was rather wonderful. And the menu was a little bit pretentious. All shirt, no trousers, the menu. And the couple on the table behind me said to the waiter, could you tell us, quoting from the menu, what the soup du jour is? And the waiter said, and he'd been trained, I'll just go and find out. So he trotted off to the... It doesn't have creek. Is this safe? Yeah. And,
it's your knees.
It's fine. God, this may just be a stage I'm going through in a minute. I'll take it. And so the waiter came back and... Oh, this was comedy gold. Apparently, it's the soup of the day. I do come from Birmingham, and it is harsh. We're always seen as a little bit thick. And it's true, but I that's where it is. I dropped the accent, by the way, because I wanted to get a job. But my dad genuinely answered any question with, ah, that's how Brummy he was. How are you doing, Dad? Ah. You know, has it been a good day? Ah, you know. And sadly, he didn't live to see me do comedy, but I know if I asked him, you know, what did you think, Dad? I know what he just said. Ah. And the NHS is being spread a little bit too thin, I think, my friends. Do you not? A little bit too thin. I was having this conversation with an ear, nose, throat, back and foot specialist who was running the X-ray department for four London hospitals last week. And he was broadly in agreement. But I think it was at our local hospital when I realised how bad things have become. There's a sign up there that said, car thieves operate at this hospital. Do you know? I know we're short of people. But that seems like a bad idea. But, you know, I want to give creative funding solutions a go. And so I thought about it a little bit more, and I thought, well, maybe, just maybe, this is a good idea. I mean, they do get in and out very fast. Yeah. They always remember to wear the gloves and the mask. And, and they're happy to wear nights. So it's all good. I'll tell you the other thing that's been bothering me recently is this French controversy around the burkini. I'm not allowed to wear the burkini on French beaches. Now, that seems very weird to me. Hands up if you've ever been to France. Of course you have. It's Primrose Hill. You've all been. But for me, I'd far rather have regulations about those French guys, a little bit overweight, not wearing those Speedos that lost the will to live in the 1970s. Do you know? So a regulation that enforces French guys to cover up would seem to be a better way to go. But they do. They banned the burkini. And my watch didn't activate. Oh, no. I have no idea, Tricia. How long have I done?
Enjoy yourself.
Is
enjoying you.
I have this very clever comedy watch, right, that has a countdown, right? And so I have to remember to press it, and then after 9 minutes, it goes, dzz, 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 and I go, oh, it's time to get on. But I have to remember to press the button to switch it on. But today, I remember to switch it on, but not to have it on the correct screen, so it went a bit pesher. But anyway, the burkini is a terrible name. It's an awful name. I mean, the burkini, it's horrible. Because the bikini, right, the bikini is named after a little atoll in the Pacific. Yeah. So, did you know that? You look sceptical, my friend, all right? Wikipedia, look it up later. This is absolutely true. The bikini is named after a little series of atolls in the Pacific. You still don't trust... Could someone verify this, please? Because I cannot bear... Thank you. Yep. It's where they did nuclear tests, so thank you. I'll do the material, but I like the attempt. So anyway. So I got to thinking, it's presumably called a bikini because it actually covers a very small area. Do you know, I thought that must be the logic of why it's called the bikini. So in that case, we don't want to call it the burkini. We should really, if we're staying with the metaphor, call it the Australian. Yeah? And that would work, wouldn't it? Because if a bikini is a very small area, the Australia operates a much, you know, covers a much larger landmass, yeah? Including, obviously, the bushlands and the Northern Territories. So, you know, the metaphor kind of works. Do you know, that was funnier in my head. That was really funny in my head. You need to be in here, because that was properly funny. So, yeah, I think I'm going to bring it into land with this one last thing. We started naming storms. That happened this time last year. We started... Do you believe me? Yes. Can you name any of the storms we've had? But they're all preset. We are in for a Storm Nigel at some point. Do you know? And I don't think I'm going to take that seriously. I'm not going to get worried about a Storm Nigel. No offence to any Nigels, but that doesn't sound very menacing. But does anyone, and I know you won't, remember Storm Gertrude? Yeah, we had Storm Gertrude. In the press, lovely story, family's pet rabbit got blown from the garden onto the garage roof. This is true. Okay, I'm not making this up. This is, you can look that up. All right, pet rabbit, Storm Gertrude, ends up on the garage roof, you see. And I thought that was funny, you know, again, in my head. But I thought it's not only funny, it could be very useful. Because I don't understand gale force or wind speeds or anything like that. But if I'm being told what size animal could potentially get blown onto the garage roof, you know, I'm equipped. So if in the morning I put the weather forecast on and they're telling me, you know, it's gerbil, I'm like, I can cope with gerbil. Just going to put my hat on a little bit tighter, right? But if they say, whoa, dog, you know, going to be a little bit nervous. I'm still going to take the dog for a walk, but I'm going to keep him on the lead. That's going to be important. And I think this would be a great way of giving us the information that we need. So, you know, just in my head again, join me in here. The synopsis at 0600. North at 0, south at 0. Viking, these are shipping areas, Viking quality channel light vessel automatic. Hamster. Maybe guinea pig. Northerly. Later, backing southwesterly. Dog, possibly later llama. Severe or very severe. I've been Ian McDonald. You've got some homework to do. Thank you for being a lovely audience.
Enjoyed him. He was talking about chocolates there and how, yeah, I knew about the little knobbly bit on the dairy milk. I'm quite a seasoned dairy milk person. Who knew? But I'm never going to eat dairy milk again because as of tonight, I'm only going to eat Fifth Dimension chocolate because they are here and sponsoring us. And I've not mentioned of other brands that are available tonight because it's all Fifth Dimension. Have you had a good time in your first half? We're going to have a fabulous time in the second half as well. There is more music to come and it's going to be sensational. But you need to get a bit more drunk. Okay. So wine is only whatever last said it was, £3. So I'd have some of that if I were you. Have a lovely break. Take about 20 minutes and we will see you back here for some more. I've just realised I've got two watches on. I've got my comedy watch and my normal watch. Hey, see you in 20 minutes. Ah, there we go. I was just about to say, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome back to the stage your MC, Pauline Eyre! Oh, thank you so much. It's lovely to be back. So, did you have a good break?
Yes.
Good. Are you drunk?
Yes.
Yay, somebody is. So, that's good. Enjoyed the first half. We'd like to thank very much our sponsors for coming, whose names I've left there, but I'm going to thank them all at the end. But it's really lovely. Some of the sponsors are here. Oh, look, splendid. Our sponsors tonight are Morford, who owns the Greenbury Cafe, and she has provided the wine. That's a beautiful name. Are you here, Morford? I'm imagining well. Russ and Albert are here from Fifth Dimension Chocolates. And guess what we've got later? Chocolate to give away! To the best comedian. Yeah, to the best comedian. We'd like you to have a think about who you would think that might be. Pete from the Olive Bar has given us these gorgeous, gorgeous olives tonight. Thank you very much, Pete! And Olivier's Bakery. Olivia's. Sorry, Primrose Hill. Olivier's Bakery at Primrose Hill Market, who gave us the bread and presumably the gorgeous oil that went with it. There was a whole table of it on my a whole plate of it, but there isn't any more. Because I need something before my chocolate for pudding. So thank you very much to all those lovely sponsors. I want to talk to you, sir, because you're here all the way from Iceland?
Yes.
Brilliant. What is your name?
Axel.
Axel. Your accent is fabulous and your English is way better than my Icelandic. I mean, I've got one word in Icelandic. Björk. Björk. That's probably Björk, isn't it?
Björk.
There you go. I have a natural ear for English. So... Welcome. Are you here for forever, or are you just visiting? Or?
A few years, maybe.
A few years. Yeah, especially with the whole Brexit. I don't know how long. And you're working here.
Yeah.
Are you working for Fifth Dimension Chocolates?
No.
What do you do for a living, Axel? Are you? What do you graphic design? Digital social marketing. All my glasses. For what kind of product? So actually, social media stuff.
Yeah.
All right, so you come up with things like, you know, Twitter's little bird. And, no. This is why I do comedy and not bloody digital marketing, social media stuff.
So.
Do you not? And who is it that you're with tonight? Hello. Your lovely lady. What's your name, Alan? Akla. That's gorgeous. Akla. Pauline. Nice to meet you. Akla. Akla and Axel. Cool names. And what do you do? In childcare, fantastic. Just one or two, nanny sort of thing, or whole nursery full? Yeah, and at what age are you looking after? Newborns. Newborns are nice. I spent this afternoon with a lot of newborns in my other job. And then I went home and invoiced So I'll just hold your baby for you. Everything going well with you? Fabulous. Just got to do my invoice. Babies are lovely. I had baby twins 12 years ago. Yeah, it's not quite so lovely. But, you know, we're recovering. Brilliant. So you're in a nursery? In a creche. We know all about creches around here. Primrose Hill. I bet there are creches in Primrose Hill, aren't there? Better posh creche. No. Do we not need creches because we have nannies? Ah! Anyone looking for a nanny at the moment? Because there's one here, she's got a gorgeous name. Agla, she's very nice and welcome. I was wondering whether you two might have a little watch of the comedians tonight and decide who you might give a box of Fifth Dimension chocolates to. So, thank you, brilliant. Any of the acts at all that you've seen, it's Pauline, P-A-U, that's fine. So I've got a list of the acts that are on. You can tell us who's the best. Fantastic. I know, my name isn't on there because I'm not allowed. That's why I'm telling you. Or the Pauline with a P. Fantastic. Eyre, like Jane. That's my surname. Actually, somebody said to me recently, so that's, oh, that's an unusual name. I said, Eyre, like Jane. And they still any relation. No. She's fictional. In the second half, we have four or five more acts for you, and they're all fabulous. One of them, I think you know. So that's going to be something big to look forward to. And at the end, we have an amazing headliner tonight, who's rather musical. And we had a musical, we had Janice's musical in the first half, and I've got a song too. Do you want to hear it?
Yeah.
Tough, you're going to anyway. Raindrops on roses and whiskers on kittens. Bright copper kettles and warm woolen mittens. Brown paper packages tied up with strings. These are a few of my recent Google searches. I'm menopausal. Oh God, the menopause. I'm looking for kittens and mittens and rainbow memes, you know, with inspirational quotes. At the end of every rainbow, there's a crock of shit. Honestly, I'm looking for rubbish. It's horrible being menopausal. But, you know, we're coming to terms with one of my biggest problems at the moment. I don't know if I can... I'll share this with you later. I'm not going to share it. It's not warm enough yet. First of all, I will tell you that I was on a train this week, and the guy next to me was leaning his thigh against mine for the whole journey. I love it when they do that, you know. Never too old for sexual harassment. Hurrah, who knew? And when I got home, I was helping my son with his French homework, and he said, Mum, how come it's la chaise and le sofa? I told you. Languages. How come, he said, how come it's la chaise and le sofa? How come a chair is female and a settee is male? He said, why is it about gender? I said, because everything's about gender, the French are just more honest about it. Sorry, I get overwhelmed. Sometimes I think it's the menopause. Oh, for God's sake, what's his name? It's just my husband. I was just telling my husband about it. I get forgetful and overwhelmed. I should tell you a bit about my husband. He's lovely. He's tall. Like, imagine a really tall black guy with beautiful eyes and really ripped. That's Idris Elba. My husband's a strong, silent type, you know. He has strong opinions. He just keeps them to himself. We're at that stage of our relationship now. We've been married over 20 years. So we're at that stage where it's like, do you love me? Still here, aren't I? And we had lunch with some friends and recently, and they had a new puppy. My husband played with the puppy all afternoon. He loved that puppy. He was so attached to the puppy. As we were leaving, he looked at the puppy and he looked at me and he went, oh, he said, when you die, I'm going to get a dog. But I am now at that stage with, I went to see a fortune teller to find out about my relationship, and I showed her my hand, and she said, he doesn't love you and you're going to die young. I thought, oh, I've got to get away from this vicious psychic. Are we enjoying these yet? Got one more to come. Thank you. Because, ladies and gentlemen, I'm now at that stage in my life, the whole menopause thing, that I have got a bathroom full of tampons. Don't need them anymore. What do you do when you get to the age? You don't need your tampons anymore. What do you do? What do women do? I'm not throwing them away because they cost a fortune. Because we're still paying the tampon tax, Brexit or no Brexit. So they cost a fortune. You know about the tampon tax, yeah? Now that we pay, women pay VAT on their sanitary products because they're seen as non-essentials. Luxury. Oh my goodness, it's a luxury. It's what women really love. You know, it's like, I used to think when I was younger that when I got PMT, when I got a bit stressed before my period, I used to think that was, you know, that whole science myth that says it's a woman's way of grieving that she's not pregnant. And I had those twins. I ain't grieving. Been there, done that, got stretch marks. That ship has sunk. So, no, I'm not grieving about that, but I know why it is. It's about the tampon tax. That's why women get ratty just before their periods. It's because we can't wait for the luxury of our next tampon. It's like an advent calendar every month for my period. Opening little doors, hoping that today will be the day, but no, just chocolate. As we know, ladies, chocolate is no substitute for menstrual stuffing. Sorry, too much? Too much. I'm sure fifth dimension. No, don't even go there, Pauline. But so for my big birthday that I was telling you about earlier, 50, for that my husband bought me a present. Well, he made it himself, actually. He said, "What do you want for your birthday?" I said, "Surprise me." I'm thinking Tiffany, Cartier, accessorize, anything. But no, he got me a little bit of luxury, just for me. That's what women really want. It's lovely. Yeah. You see, because I'm coming to terms with the fact that, you know, when the kids fight, when there's man spread, well, I'm feeling mad. I skip to the loo and insert my lilette, and then I don't feel so bad. You know what I'm going to do? With all these luxurious things in my bathroom, I'm just going to pop them up there anyway. It's lovely. This is what we want. I'm wearing on the outside. Wearing one on the inside as well. I know. It's comedy. If you like some proper singing, then later on tonight we have a fabulous, or two fabulous divas tonight, actually. We have a fabulous diva coming to give away our special chocolates. More of her later. And we have a fabulous diva as our headliner tonight as well. Victoria Howden said that's something to look forward to. But we have more fun in the meantime. And if you... Who was here last time?
Yay!
So you remember, this act was so popular last time we brought him back. But we introduced him in a special way, do you remember? So I'm going to split this room in half. This half of the room, I want you to shout at me, Lou!
Lou!
And this half of the room, I want you to shout at me, Beau! Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage, Luba Chalkbody!
Hi, thanks, that's good. I've got something to confess. I'm also going through menopause. It's a tough thing. It's really tough because I'm getting mood swings as well. I'm just chocolate. Chocolate just seems, I mean, I know I'm made of chocolate, but it just seems to be my thing. I'm Lubo, thanks. I'm Lubo, and I'm from Africa. Thanks. I generally like telling people that because I like the look of disappointment on their faces when I tell them that because I know I am not the African you're expecting to see. You know, the ones you see on TV, you're like the live-aid African. You know, the no shirt, big belly, fly around the mouth, 10-year-old kid. Yeah, I know. I used to be one of them, thanks. Until you, a lot of the people donated £2. So thank you for donating. Thank you for donating. True story, right? Bob Geldof, he bought me for Christmas. He wanted to give me a true Christmas experience. And it never happened, sadly. It seems no one told him, like, Africans are not only for Christmas. No, for Easter too. So true story, like, I have an uncle. You know my uncle, right? My uncle. You know my uncle. Yeah. You know the one who is from Nigeria. He's like, you know, he's holding an inheritance, and he's got that uncle, right? You have to give him your details, your bank details, to release your head. Yeah. That uncle, right? He said to me, he's like, you know, you have to market yourself. As a child actor, failed child actor, Live Aid, he said, you've got to market yourself, right? You've got to go on a special diet, like method acting. Because, like, it's really hard to get just, like, the belly and small limbs, you know? So you just go on a diet of, like, gluten. This is, like, loads and loads. Because you guys never send the gluten stuff, like, gluten-free stuff to Africa, do you? I mean, like, there's a lot of, like, celiacs in Africa, but we don't know what it is, so we just eat bread. too much for Primrose? Is it too strong? So I recently became British. Some of you remember from last time that I recently became British, and I've been experiencing a lot of great things in my life, and I've been experiencing your British cues. I've really tried, because like queuing doesn't exist in Africa. We just have like gatherings by waterholes, right? And how it. Something as simple as going to the bank, right? Because you go to the bank and it's a nice queue, right? But like in Africa, when I go to the bank, right, this is what happens. Because like you have to be really clever on how you're going to deposit your money, because everything works in a bribe. But if you're going to give them money, you're going to lose a bit too much. So I went to the bank in Africa, I was trying to get some money, and he goes, how much money are you going to deposit today? I was like, oh, trick question, right? I was like, how much can I deposit? And he goes, it depends how much you've got. Wink. Now, I said, right, I'll put in 100. Right? And he says, it's 100 for me. I said, don't wink at me. Like, I will put in what I need to put in. Wink. I said, no, stop the winking. Right? So, basically, I've got a lot of retainer, bank clerks on retainer to just, like, pay them off in case I need to put money in. Coming over here from Africa, I've noticed something, Primrose. You know, I tend to be the talking black friend to a lot of my friends. I get invited a lot for dinner. Like I've got a friend named Richard. He's like, Lubo, come for dinner. So I was like, cool, I'll come because I'm hungry. All right. And he said, Lubo, I told my friends I've got a black friend, so I need you to be black for the night. All right. And I thought this was quite strange. I said, I'll come. And he says, no, I told friends, I've got black friends, so you need to be black, like, be black, because you're a coconut. No, most of you know what a coconut is. Someone who's like brown on the outside, but you know, white on the inside. So essentially, I'm just like you, right? I'm essentially just like you, right? And I'm quite cultured, because I was like, right, Richard Crew, what time is dinner? I'll come. And when you go for dinner, you know, you take a bottle with you, don't you? It's a red. If it's red meat, you take a bottle of red wine, isn't it? Yeah. If it's white meat, you take a bottle of white wine. Yeah. Yeah. So I'm like, Richard, what's for dinner? And it says coq au vin, which I know is chicken in red sauce, right? And red wine. So I was like, I'll bring a drink. And so I showed up 8 o'clock on time with my bottle of Ribena. because yeah, right. And he got upset with me because he told me, he says, Lubo, I told everyone inside that black people is late, so I need you to be stand outside for like 20 minutes, so you can be late. And at this point, I didn't know whether to be impressed or offended that Richard knew a lot more about being black than I did. So I kind of went on with it, right? And this is how, well, we walked in, this is how Richard introduced me to a room full of white people, but like, you know, and he goes, Judith, put the glass down. This is my friend, Cassius. It's not my name, right? It's from the hood, it's from the streets, it's from the ghetto. I went to boarding school, right? And at this point, he looks at me, and I know how to say something that's profoundly black. And the only thing that came to my mind was, ta-da, I'm black! Like, there's some kind of magic trick. And like, and that went on, right? And Richard goes, Cash is gonna spit some bars. Do you want to spit some bars? No, did I? Why do you know? Let's spit some bars. Spit some bars, I found out, was rap, right? I had to rap. God. This is how it went down, rapping, right? I said, ice, ice, baby. Ice, ice, baby. Now stop. At this point, I looked over at Judith, and she's like, ooh, I can rap. And I was just like, yeah, right. And she got up and she goes, stop, drop, kaboodle, remember the neighborhood, some calling me ludicrous, some calling me from the world. I was like, damn, Judith, you know better than I am. Jeez, I can't even get that right. I can't get that right. Oh. And she looks at me and she's like, do you have some of the, do you have some? And I said, seriously, Judith? Is that what you think of me? I did, I had some in my pocket. But I just feel like the fact she assumed that I did have some, like, that's just stereotypical racist. You know what I mean? Do people smoke in this room? Do you have smokers? No, they're all dead. That's alright. I think I like smoking is only socially acceptable, like, addiction. You know, like, no other addiction features an application for. Like, do you drink? Like, if you put, are you an alcoholic? Yes or no? And you tick yes, you're not going to get a job. But, like, if you're smoking and you're smoking, yes or no, it's fine. Like, you can go for a job, right? I'm like, sorry, boss, I need to go out for, like, a 5 minute five break. But we need to start fighting for equality of all addictions. Like, especially, like, my addiction. You know what I mean? You know what I mean, right? Just, like, 5 minutes of me and you. I mean, you look like a wanker. So, I mean, we can go out. Just, like, 5 minutes, just me and you. Because all you need is just, like, one. It takes just, like, two of us. You know, just, like, two dicks outside. You know, just splashing one out. This is what we need. guys, you've been lovely. I've been Lula, and this is a good man. Thank you so much for listening, guys.
I didn't understand what he meant, personally. Kid, I love coming, ladies and gentlemen. We've got somebody wonderful for you now, but you know her already. Please welcome lovely, gorgeous Trish Barton to the stage.
Thank you. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, all this talk of menopause, in my case, it's more like a menopause storm. I mean, at my age, it really would be an unexpected item in the banking area. But welcome from Rose Hill, friends, neighbours, and those of you from farther afield, don't be afraid. We're not all A-list celebrities yet. Although I have tried, God knows I've tried, I've hung around outside the Queen's pub, trying to look sort of casual, pouting. I've watered diaphanously over Primrose Hill, trying to look winsome. The paparazzi take not the blindest bit of notice. Can't think why. Anyway, I've lived around these parts for 25 years. So can I see anybody here from Primrose Hill who's lived here longer?
Hey,
yes? Lala, tell me, how long have you lived here, darling? How long have you lived in this area?
Since
1981. Wow. There, ladies and gentlemen, is the diva of Primrose Hill, and she's been here since 1981. Respect, respect. Oh. So really, I am a parvenu. I am a newcomer in your eyes. No, anyway. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I live down in the Darwin Court flats at the bottom of Gloucester Avenue. Some of you here, you know where that is. And I rather like it down there because we rub shoulders with Camden Town. There's a laugh there. And do you know what? Somebody said to me one day, oh, you look down, you live down beyond the border. The border? The border? So then we'll talk about we'll build a wall. Not only that, we'll get you lot at the north end of the village to pay for it. And not only that, I'll be sending Phil Cowan around to ask for money. Because we know he likes to do that, and he does it rather well. Anyway, I do like living down at the bottom end of Gloucester Avenue, because, I'm rattling. When I come out of my flat, I turn right for artisan bread, cupcakes, olive oil, extra virgin olive oil, trampled by the feet of nuns in the Tuscan hills, and dogs. So many dogs in Primrose Hill. Come out of my flat and turn left for Camden Town and dog shit.
Actually, it's a bit unfair. I'm being a bit unfair about Camden Town because it is coming up in the world. Do we agree? It is coming up in the world. Has a Waitrose now. Now, one of the things I like to do, though, when I go into Waitrose is I like to have a little bit of urban cred. So I like to go into Waitrose with a little bag. It doesn't quite work in reverse, though. Just look like a policy twat. And Parkway. How gentrified has Parkway got now? It has an Oliver bonus, full of shiny things you never knew you wanted. I like to waft into Oliver bonus. Imagine I'm shopping for the life I imagine I'm leading, and then nip round to pound round. My lovely neighbour Jane is here tonight, and I've got a confession to make to you. You know those beautiful fragrant room oils I bought you for your birthday? For your aromatherapy diffuser. Came from Poundland. as I like to say, Camden Town is coming up in the world, so I'm not going to diss it, because I love Camden Town, and I do love Primrose Hill, and I think we are good neighbours, side by side. I have one final story. When I first moved into this area, I swear this is true, I picked up the Camden New Journal, the CNJ, which is our very excellent free newspaper, and there was a story in it about the drugs problem in Camden Town. And which is quite a serious problem, as we know. But rather helpfully, they printed a map. And so I learned that I could get hash in the high street, poppers in Parkway, coke in Camden Market. Superdrug could barely compete. Anyway, that's all I have to say about living around our area. Can I just say thank you so much, all of you, for coming tonight. I want to thank my fellow organisers while I'm here, Lars and Phil and Jason and Peter and everyone who's helped us put on the night. Also, and most importantly, all the fantastic comedians that you've seen and are still going to see. As you can see, I'm the one who's still trying, but I can't actually ask them all to give up their night without me having a go, so bear with me. And I'd particularly like to thank Pauline, because Pauline has been amazing. Can we have a big cheer for Pauline? And I'm going to hand back to the lovely Pauline now and enjoy the rest of your evening.
Please keep that lovely room and keep it coming for your next act, Peter Merritt!
Thank you very much, Pauline. Following the local hero, oh, no pressure. So, Primrose Hill, this is very posh for me. I'm from a place called Bethnal Green. Yeah, you've heard of it. Your chauffeurs take you past it occasionally. Or if you are on the central line, it's where you pass in somewhere more glamorous like Mile End or Stratford. If you've not been to Bethnal Green recently, let me be the unofficial tour guide for you. 4 years ago, during the Olympics, or the East London Olympics, as I like to call it, I did apply to be an official tour guide for the area. First application form, didn't hear anything back. Second application form, didn't hear anything back. Third application form, racked it round a brick, put it through the council window at 3 o'clock in the morning. I am unofficial. So if you're in Bethnal Green, some famous places, famous people. We've got the pie and mash shop in Bethnal Green Road, no pie and mash. Traditional Cockney food, you'll find me in there pre-gig. Pie and mash jelly deal sometimes, you know, push the boat out on a Friday. Brick Lane, you know Brick Lane? World famous Sunday market. Buy anything you want down Brick Lane. No receipts, though. No, you can't bring it back. That's Marks and Spencer's, pretty much. Don't get them confused. So in Brick Lane, we've got the bagel shop. It's 24 hours. They haven't got a key for the door, basically. Someone stole it. But it's 24 hours. You can your traditional Jewish food, but adopted by the Cockneys. You'll find me in there post-gig tonight, maybe. Bit of salt beef, no mustard. Didn't too spicy for me. And famous people from Bethnal Green. We've got the Cray Twins, the gangsters that ruled London in the 60s. You know the Cray Twins?
Yeah.
So what I'm saying to you is pie mash, bagels, Cray Twins, as long as you feed us. No trouble. There'll be no trouble. You know. I listen to a lot of local radio in Bethnal Green. It's nice. We get about one stabbing a week. Nice to know where the road closures are, blood spill is. Go down and take a picture, social media, you know, push your profile, local comedian. So, Christmas Eve, local radio, news, traffic, weather, usual stuff. we go over to Bethlehem for a carol service. I was expecting the stabbing, you know. So I did some research. Is there any connection between Bethnal Green and Bethlehem? There is. There is. There is indeed. Lack of affordable accommodation, basically. Babies being brought in a manger off the old Bethnal Green Road. Yeah. But then there's there are differences, of course, between the two places. In Bethlehem, in Bethnal Green, we've got an education problem. You know, there's no grammar schools in Bethnal Green. In Bethnal Green, we do not have the three wise men. Or a virgin. I've been looking. Is there any athletes in the room? Primrose, there must be a few in Primrose Hill. A few 5Kers. So we built this stadium, this Olympic stadium, for 2 weeks for the Olympics, 2 weeks for the Paralympics, and it's just sitting there empty. There's a football team moving. We don't want to talk about that. But I'm talking about that team. Don't like that team. So they use it for community events now to regenerate East London, and it fucking needs regenerating, to believe me. So I signed up for a 10K. You run around the Olympic Park, past the Copper Box, the Velodrome, the Media Centre, and you finish inside the Olympic Stadium. True story. Technically, I am an Olympian. I got medals. I should have been in Rio, but I've got the tag on my ankle, obviously. So. So it's a true story. I raised £750 for Great Ormond Street. Correct response. No punchline, just to let you know I'm a nice guy, you know. I can have your kneecaps, but, you know, drive-by shooting, but make it look like an accident. But I am a nice guy. So, so the second week, the following week, I really enjoyed it. It was a great buzz, running around, but, you know, keeping fit, that little way. So the second week, I signed up for a 5K in Victoria Park in East London. You know Victoria Park? Yeah. Love Box Festival, Music Festival, Field Day. But, you know, it's this fantastic park. I worked out every time I run, I'm just getting a bit closer to where I live. Every time in Bethnal Green. So I know, lazy, right? You know, I'm meant to be running and keeping fit and becoming like an Olympian. So the third weekend, I did a 2K, ran a coffee table in my front room. Obviously, that's a joke. We haven't got coffee tables yet in Bethnal Green. You're confusing us with Shoreditch and Hoxton, the hip places. You didn't read the tour booklet I gave out at the beginning. So that's the Olympian stuff. So Eddie Izzard recently ran 27 marathons in 27 days. He's not here, don't clap him. He's not here. He's down here. No, he raised millions for sport relief, you know. He's actually, he came back because he ran them in Africa, him and Lupe, it was the two of them together. I was going to say I can't see him, but no, so I shouldn't say that. Sorry, Lupe, sorry. Lower the tone, Primrose Hill, they'll be escorting me out now. Do you know what? I've done my first ever gig in Cecil Sharp House, down the road. Yeah. That was 10 years ago. I've done a comedy course, 8 weeks, and then we've done the performance in Cecil Sharp House. And that was my first ever gig 10 years ago. This is my second gig. Not really. 121. So, Eddie Izzard, he's a football fan. So after he came back, he went to Crystal Palace, who he supports, and they dragged him out on the pitch at Sellers Park, they dragged him out on the pitch at half-time, and they said, Eddie, fantastic achievement, well done, all over the television, all over the radio, all over the news, you know, the internet, brilliant, fantastic, you raised millions, you know, but you're one of us, you're a Crystal Palace fan, we want to give you something, we want to reward you. So, Eddie, we're going to give you a free Crystal Palace season ticket. And the PA man goes, so Eddie looks at him and he goes, I've just run the 27 marathons. Do you not think I've suffered enough? Are we football fans? So the Euros, England were crap, weren't they, in the Euros? They went out to Iceland. That was embarrassing. We've got a few Iceland fans in. Oh dear. I've already told you I can have people kneecaps. Okay, no, you're very welcome, You know, you deserved it on the night, you absolutely deserved it. Okay, talking to the YouTube now, I've got fans watching from America. So this is on YouTube. I've got some stuff on Hillary later. They're not going to like it. So we lost to Iceland and they sacked Roy Hodgson and they brought in Sam Allardyce, who's in a bit of a long ball game. So I'm not sure what's worse. Big Sam as England manager, or Boris Johnson as Foreign Secretary? Yeah, after the Brexit, I've mentioned the Brexit, yeah. So, Cameron's gone, I think Cameron had been trying to get sacked for like about a year, and he's like a football manager trying to get the conversation. First of all, there was the penis in the pig situation. And there was the Panama Papers, the tax, the offshore family account. And the third one was like, he in front of the Queen and in front of the cameras, he said, oh, the Nigerians, they're fantastically corrupt. He's been trying to get sacked for a year. And I don't know, it was Cameron fans in, I don't know. So, and Farage has gone. Farage has quit for the second time. He quits every year, didn't he, Farage? He quit after the general election, he's quit after the Brexit. Ironically, Farage's resignations, they get earlier each year. A bit like Ramadan. You know, there you go. Political satire, Ramadan and Farage in the same joke, same punchline. It's pretty good. And so we've got any Jeremy Corbyn fans in? Is this called Corbyn? Yeah. I'm in favour of Corbyn because like, I'm after a Prime Minister. I'd vote for a Prime Minister that dresses worse than I do. I support him, Whether the Labour Party support him or not, that's the problem. So, and we've got a new Prime Minister as well, Theresa May. In America, they've got Obama. Positive attitude. Yes, we can. In England, in the UK now, we've got Theresa. Maybe. Yeah, she comes through my gigs. Yeah, so it doesn't matter. So it's obviously a predictable joke, isn't it? Obviously. So in America now, it's going to be between Hillary and Trump, isn't it? And Hillary's been a bit ill in the last week, had pneumonia. I'm not into conspiracy theories. My friend's massive into them, but I'm not into them. But did anybody notice she went fell ill at the 9/11 ceremony last weekend? Did anybody notice she sort of fell down, the same as the towers? Shouldn't do that one, because we're live on the internet to a moment. Shouldn't have done that joke, yeah. So, Donald Trump, controversial figure. Sean was talking about him earlier. Controversial figure. After the Paris bombings, Donald Trump said, if I become the next president of the United States, I'm going to ban any more Muslims from coming to this country. Controversial. I'll say one thing for Donald Trump before I go. The Don, the Trump stuff. Got a lot of pressure on you. He says what other people are thinking. And when I say other people, Nigel Farage. Katie Hopkins. Yeah. Cab driver that brought me here tonight. I say cab driver, it's actually my racist uncle from Bethnal Green.
Oh. You should have heard him during the break, though, people. He was saying, you know, I can kneecap people if I don't get food at a gig. I don't think he realised that the beautiful bread and olive oil. We have quinoa here, we don't do jelly deals. So, back to menopause. Because it's all about me, isn't it? Just one more thing, really, to say about the menopause, because I feel I should take the tone a little bit more serious. That now, of course, I can't have any more children. Yeah. No more children. No more periods. No more period pain. No more tampons. No more tampon tax. Ladies and gentlemen, I am finally off that vicious menstrual cycle. Last one, I promise. We have two more acts for you tonight. Woo! Are you excited?
Yes!
Have you got your singing voices on? You may need them later. But before that, we have Matthew, is he local? Is Matthew local? He's not local. So ignore that. Something she wrote on the piece of paper. Local act / Matthew Truesman. I think it's local act if any of you stood up. Or Matthew Truesman. When we do this next time, if we do this next time, we can do this again, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. If we do this next time, maybe you'd like to come and have a go. Somebody from Primrose Hill, that would be awesome. But before that, this time, Matthew Truesmith is our next act, but you're not making any noise, so I can't bring him on.
Ha ha ha. men who were trying to hold on to their youth by wearing very skinny jeans. You know those sort of men, you know those sort of men. Terribly skinny jeans and sort of suit jacket. Then they try and do some stand-up comedy as well. Just to kind of hold on to their youth, those sort of people. Yeah. Anyway, I'm mentioning that because I'm actually here tonight, ladies and gentlemen. I'm here tonight with my daughter Wendy. Now, sadly, she won't mind me saying this, but sadly, Wendy and I's mum, daughter Wendy and I's her mum and we're not together anymore. She's now she's with Tony now, but Wendy's here to support me. Hey, Wendy! Wendy, morning everybody. Now, I had a very peculiar dream last night. I was on a boat at the time and there was somebody coming towards us crossing the water. But I'd like to just take you through that. So we're going to reenact it. I'm going to be the man in the dream, okay? And you're going to be me in the dream, effectively. You're on the boat. You're going to be watching the man coming towards you, which is me, in the dream. Okay, ready? Let's go. Smooth.
If you don't know that in the woods, do it! Because you want to be big surprise! If you don't know that in the woods, do it! You better go in disguise! For all the men and everyone, they can't do that for certain, because today is the day that Daddy Man has to be with me!
And then the alarm went off. Now, this is the point in the act where, just for comic effect, a bit like these trousers, just for sort of comic effect, I pretend that I don't know what I'm doing. I've lost a bit of that. I've completely forgotten what I'm doing. Don't worry, I know you're not in it. But don't worry, because actually, I have got this. Yeah. It's an aiuto mnemonica, which is Italian for aide mémoire, which is French, of course, for French. Okay, so tell them about the dream and then... Oh, yes! Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the funny picture.
Yes! Woo!
Sorry, actually it's not a funny picture, it's just a man... promoting onion goggles. You put them on your face and they sort of stop your eyes from leaking. Yeah, that's my onion goggles. Aide mémoire. Just use the aide mémoire. Just got it. It's the aide mémoire. Oh yes, ladies and gentlemen. The wife I married, hey, Wendy. The wife I married, well, she was much smaller, okay, she was much smaller and wider than me. Yeah, she was much smaller and wider. Much smaller and wider. But you know what really brought us together? She absolutely loved it. Honestly, she loved it. When I'd run after her, I'd catch her, run after her, run around the garden and catch her. She absolutely loved it. But don't take my word for it, ladies and gentlemen, because guess what? Yes, she's here tonight. She's in the little brown case, so let's get her out. And ladies and gentlemen, I give you my wife! Actually, sorry, it's obviously not my wife, ladies and gentlemen, because because this came back. But the truth is, I did actually try to get my wife back by baking her a cake at the weekend. I was inspired, I thought I'd try and bake a cake. It wasn't going too well at all. So I went down to my local cookery shop and they gave me this. Ignore that. Should be easy to do. Yeah, they gave me this, ladies and gentlemen. They gave me this. Yeah? You know what it is, don't you? Yeah? You know, yeah. It's a Mary Berry wig. That's right. A Mary Berry wig. Listen, just before I got here, you know, I was teaching some kids and I was thinking up some funny ideas. I thought, I'll get to Primrose Hill and they'll love that. They'll love the Mary Berry stuff. They'll love the funny thing about the fish, getting the fish out and, you know, well, they'll all really, Wendy, forgive me. That's better, yes. just to finish off. By this point, you should look exactly like the picture you showed everyone at the beginning. And everyone will be cheering and laughing. Some will be nodding quietly to themselves and saying, oh, that's genius, that is. Must go and see him again. He was very funny, yeah. Whatever you do, do not read this part out loud. If you have read this part out loud, you should leave the stage immediately. Thank you. Thank you for having me, Primrose Hill. I clearly haven't been myself, but I have been Matthew Tinsley. Thank you. And very much.
And we have one more act for you this evening before we bring on Lana Belay. Lana Belay, who's going to come and give her our chocolates at the end. Woo! Celebrity and fabulousness, who's going to come up. And before that, we have our headline act this evening, who is a musical comedian called Victoria Howland. And she's wonderful. She's so good at doing amazing things with songs. I've written one for her. How do you solve a problem like Victoria? Give her a headline spot at Primrose Hill. There is just no problem with Victoria. She's the perfect addition to any comedy bill. Oh, how do you solve a problem like Victoria? Oh, that's high. She's the perfect Saturday night alternative to Netflix and chill. Which is why we're bringing on somebody now who's really good at musical comedy. And can write songs that are so much better than that. So are you ready to welcome her? Yeah. She's fabulous. She's not going to want this microphone down here. She's going to want this microphone. When I grow down, I'm going to be just like Victoria. Okay, so are you ready? It's our final act of this evening, ladies and gentlemen. Have you had a good time? Yeah. We're about to have an even better time for the next 10 minutes or so. Ladies and gentlemen, Victoria Howland! I love my song! Let's give a huge round of applause to Pauline Eyre, everybody! You're a wonderful MC and a lovely friend, and writing songs about me. So, hello everybody, how are you? Good, it's so nice to be here. So, I'm Victoria, and as it's been mentioned a few times, I'm a musical theatre fan! Good, a few musical theatre fans in, nice. You know what? I love a musical because in the musicals, anything is possible. You know, anything can happen. A man can fall in love with a woman within 5 minutes whilst doing the jazz hands. You know, that's pretty fabulous. Cats can sing and dance and have clinical depression. And little orphan Annie can save the day. She can practically save America by singing The Sun Will Come Out Tomorrow to President Roosevelt.
I'm the one with the microphone, baby. So you better shut up and listen to me.
So little orphan Annie can save the day by singing "The Sun Will Come Out Tomorrow" to President Roosevelt. I wonder if orphan Annie were around today, what would she be singing to Donald Trump? The best thing I could come up with is, "Your hair'll fall out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow you'll be bald, you racist prick." That was the best I could come up with for that. So if you have any other suggestions, they're very welcome. And you are never alone in a musical. I think that's my favourite thing about the musicals. You're never alone, because in the town that always seems to be made of cardboard, there are always the townspeople. You know, townspeople hanging out in the background, waiting for something to happen. And then the lead breaks forward and breaks into song about absolutely nothing. "Good morning, Baltimore." She's singing "Good morning" to Baltimore. I mean, that's pretty fabulous, isn't it? And then all the townspeople, they turn into these fantabulous dancers, don't they? "Every day is an open door." I love it so much, I decided to try it in my own neighbourhood, yeah? So, I woke up one morning, and I flung open the window and I sang, "Good morning, Lewisham." And all the drug dealers looked up and waved. Oh, it was great, I loved it. But I noticed that the straight men don't seem to like the musicals very much. You know, I've been with many a man, and none of them has been a musical theatre fan. As a matter of fact, I couldn't find the right guy for me, you know, the guy that would tick all my boxes. And then, about 8 years ago, I was in a band, I was a singer. And in the band was a guitar player named Shuli. And Shuli and I became really good friends. We could talk about anything, we really connected, we would spend hours and hours together. And I thought, wow, how nice to have this new amazing best friend. Then one day, in rehearsal, we were sitting together, and our thighs touched. And ooh, baby. There was enough electricity going up and down my body, I could light the bloody shard. Figured out I had more than friendly feelings for Shuli. And all the time, there was this show tune playing over and over in my head. "I feel pretty, oh so pretty, I feel pretty and witty and gay." Yes, that's right, Primrose Hill. Shuli is a woman. So I'm in love with this woman, right? And I don't know what to do, I'm confused. This has never happened to me before, you know? There was no dictionary for me to look at to see what this all meant. You know, I mean, what do I do now? Do I go out and get a bunch of plaid shirts and apply for a truck driver's license? I mean, I don't know. As they say in Spanish, no habla el español. I did not know what to do. But in the midst of my confusion, the goddess of all things feminine put her arms around me and her hand on my heart and said, "Let's be honest. You found everything that you've been looking for. So don't cry for me, Argentina. You're up on a new adventure." I was writing and starring in a brand new musical. And the name of my musical? Vegetarian is the New Vegan. Thank you. My favourite part of my new musical is the first love song. The set is her bedroom. Lesbian townspeople in the background. She looking down, playing her guitar, and she looks up at me. She looks straight at me, and every time our eyes met, I wanted to move to Lesboland. That would be a delight. Wearing oversized t-shirts and eating fish. The feeling was so wrong, but it felt so right. Every time our eyes met, I wanted to move to Lesboland.
live on Diesel Dyke Drive. Doing all our DIY, we'll paint our closet salmon pink, and our periods will be perfectly in sync. Oh, every time our eyes met, I wanted to move to Lesboland. Every time our eyes met, my lady parts would just expand. I just wanted to be with her all the time. I could not think straight. So take me out on a tits parade. I can hardly wait. Waving goodbye to Cock Fosters and moving to Shepherd's Bush. All I need is one more look to give me the final push. Every time our eyes met, I wanted to move to Lesboland, live in the gay bird. Not a prickly beard or a hairy back in sight. That is it, I'm moving there for good. Put your hands together. Every time our eyes met, I wanted to move to Lesboland. Every time our eyes met, yeah, you can sing the chorus. Every time our eyes met, I wanted to move to Lesboland. Every time our eyes met, yeah, straight men sing it too. Every time our eyes met, I wanted to move to Lesboland. Every time our eyes met, my lady parts would just expand. I'm moving to Lesboland. And my favourite part of my musical, my all-time favourite, happened 2 years ago at the Lewisham Registry Office when we got married. Yeah, thank you, thank you. And she is even watching this being live streamed. Hi, she! So yeah, we got married and it was, you know, it was wonderful. We wanted to expand the family, though. We want to have kids. So when I was living in Straitsville, the sperm thing that you obviously need wasn't a problem. There was an abundance of sperm. There were waterfalls of sperm. Sperm was in the streets. I was singing in the sperm, just singing in the sperm. I was great. That sperm was coming out in that 2 days a week. Fantastic. But I'll tell you, Lesboland is having a serious drought. Now, you know, when I was living in Straitsville and I'd see a cute guy in the street, I'd think, ooh, sexy. Now when I see a cute guy in the street, I think, ooh, donor. Troubling times. So one has to import the sperm from Straitsville to Lesboland via the online sperm bank. And it is the weirdest, strangest thing. I mean, let's be honest. Going online to buy sperm is weird. You know, and just to think how much available sperm there is, there's quite a bit in this room, I can smell it. So guys, if you ever feel like having a wank in public, just carry a cup with you. You never know when you'll find a lesbian in need. All I'm saying. So you go online, but it's like Amazon, but for sperm. It's spermazon. So you choose your different men according, not men, man, according to what we're looking for, and then we have to choose how many mouthfuls we actually need. And then you add to basket. So I now have me a basket of sperm, and I proceed to check out with it. You know, it should be like on Amazon. People who bought this sperm also bought. This nice array of penis-shaped circulators. And these Dolce & Gabbana test tubes. You know, or like have custom reviews like on Amazon, you know.
Love this sperm. My baby seems to go with everything and compliments our floral scatter cushions perfectly. A must buy, 5 stars.
Or like, do not buy this sperm, exclamation point. Had this baby over a year ago and it seems to only crawl around in a circle. And every time it cries, I swear it's to I Walk the Line by Johnny Cash. Do not recommend, 1 star. But I've got some good news, we found a donor! Yeah! Number 346,
6'8", bless him. And the sperm actually flew over here from Denmark. Yeah. So, yeah, and you know, these days, anything is possible, just like in the musicals. So, number 3468, we are so grateful to you that this goes out to you. There's no semen like your semen. Like no semen I know. Every little swimmer is amazing. Every tiny squirt came out just fine. Now we really hope you're not a psycho and our kid kills us when he is nine. There's no semen like your semen. You seem like a swell guy. We hope that you had a good time on the job and washed your hands before you touched your knob. Number 3468, thank you for the blob. Let's come on with the show. Let's come on with the show.
Welcome another beautiful diva to the stage, ladies and gentlemen. Lana Pele is here. Please come and join us. Are you ready? Are you ready, you two? You've got your winner. You've got your winner. Have you conferred with the judges?
It's me, everyone.
I'm not doing 5 minutes. Who's the winner? I'm here to present the chocolates. Who's the winner? Oh, thank you. It's Björk. Thank you, Björk. Oh! So, in the fourth place was Sean Sellers, is it? Obviously the daughter of Peter. And then there's, oh, I thought that was an Armacogan, but it isn't. It's Amira Saeed. Could you please keep the camera angles high, stand on the chair or the table? And then there is, second place, Janice Hayes. Who's Janice? Oh, Janice, you were talking about a wicked queen earlier, weren't you? Well, be careful what you wish for, girl. Because gender is a myth. And at best, a scam. Ain't that right, child? And I really enjoyed your Forbidden Broadway, by the way. I've never met a lesbo before. Not in my lifetime. Very well done, thank you. And in first place is Ian McGonagall. Come on, Ian. Oh!
Lovely.
Oh, that's nice. It's a shame you don't like chocolate, Ian.
Anyway.
Get past the garter. It's actually a giggle bell. Do you know why it's a giggle bell? Get past that and you're laughing, baby. Anyway, well done, Ian, and thank you very much, and thank you for opening the door for me earlier. Mind the mat. Thank you, and thank you once again. Thank you. Sorry, I'm withdrawing from heroin. Sorry, Pauline. Wonderful, Pauline, and everybody. And because life is not a competition, regardless of what the tourist, sorry. I told you, in this climate of the end of empathy, they fucking think life is not a competition, so please give yourselves a wonderful cheer and round of applause. Thank you.
Thank you,
Pauline. What a star, ladies and gentlemen! Living local and you don't have to worry about getting home. Safe, very short journey home, a very long journey if you live as far away as Peter does. Have a gorgeous night and we'll see you again soon. Take care.